Inarigavir is under evaluation in multiple phase II trials in HBV at the moment. As Mala said so very nicely, it's a novel oral selective immunomodulator given once daily, and its mechanism of action is dual. It tries to restore the hepatocyte's selective innate and adaptive immune response. It does this predominantly by being very highly taken up through the OATP1 transporters into the hepatocyte, where it's concentrated about 30-1 compared to plasma. And then we've demonstrated that in the presence of viral infections, the activation of the innate sensors, the pattern recognition receptors, is greater when there's a virus present in the infected hepatocyte versus not present. Its secondary effect has been elucidated very nicely by Steve Locarnini's group and Haito Guo's group, which suggests that it has a direct-acting effect on inhibition of the priming of the pregenomic RNA with the DNA polymerase. We've done multiple mechanism of action studies, which I'm not going to go through in any great detail, that demonstrate the activity. What I always like to remind people is that this is really a host-mediated target, and actually we have programs against RSV using inhaled forms of Inarigavir, and it's also effective against other viruses like norovirus, hepatitis C, where we've demonstrated it in humans, and so we think of it as a pan-genotypic, a pan-viral antiviral agent due to this host activity. The ACHIEVE study is really a fairly straightforward study. It was initially designed in two parts. Part A was a dose-finding study using cohorts of 20 patients, of whom they were randomized 4-1 to active to placebo, all non-cirrhotic, all non-treated, non-previously treated, so they're naive, non-cirrhotic patients, and they get either Inarigavir or placebo. As each cohort completes, the next cohort starts after a certain number of patients complete. We're just completing cohort number 4, 200 milligrams. It actually completes on Friday. And the study is completely placebo-controlled with multiple primary and secondary endpoints, primary being safety and antiviral effect, plus multiple immunological and other viral biomarkers. At the end of the 12-week period for this, all of the patients are switched to tenofovir, 300 milligrams daily, and this is part of a collaboration with Gilead Sciences. The part B was going to be a study where we looked at combination of Inarigavir with tenofovir given at the same time. Gilead Sciences has taken that over from us and are actually running that at the current period of time, including a viral suppressed study. The baseline demographics of the three cohorts that I'm going to report really reflect very much what we would expect to see. The studies are being done in Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Canada. Most of the patients are genotype B and C, but as you can see, there are some patients that are also A and D. I've divided them into E antigen positive and E antigen negative patients because we have differential responses across the different types of patients. You can see that the majority of patients are young. E antigen positive dominated about 2-1. All of the patients have elevated ALT at baseline, and there's the expected difference in viral burden with the E antigen positive patients having more virus by a couple of logs than the E antigen negative patients. As we look at the three doses that we've reported to date, you can see that we have a very nice dose-dependent response, which is highly significant compared to placebo as we go from 25, 50 to 100 milligrams of Inarigavir, but for both DNA and RNA. I enjoyed the talks about measuring RNA. What we find here is that in the E-negative patients, a lot of patients, it's very hard to actually detect RNA at baseline. So the numbers of patients that we have RNA data with are less, obviously, than we have DNA data with, particularly in this E-negative population. It's not a problem, as other people commented, in E-positive patients. So we see a nice dose response as we go through here. And the 200 milligrams dose we hope to report relatively soon. This again shows in E-positive patients the dose response. Here the dose response is less apparent at the lower doses. In fact, there is no significant DNA response at the 25 milligram dose, and that only becomes apparent as we go to 50 and 100. The RNA response, again, we only actually see a significant response in RNA reduction when we're at the 100 milligram dose, and there's no difference between placebo at the 25 and 50 milligram doses. And we have done a lot of work on predictors of response to see why this is the case and what is the differential between E-negative and E-positive patients. One of the nice things about this study is that it's placebo-controlled, and it also has this switch component. So you can actually look at the effect of nucleotides on responses. And this just looks at our placebo patients, and it looks at their DNA response. Obviously, in the first 12 weeks, they're on placebo. Then they switch over to tenofovir. And you can see a standard nice DNA response with about 3 log reduction at 12 weeks. You then look at the RNA response, and as noted before, there actually is very little RNA response in these e-antigen, in these placebo-treated patients who are both e-antigen positive and e-antigen negative. When we look at the e-antigen negative patients at the time of response, you can see that there is a DNA and an RNA response that's occurring between baseline and week 12 on the enoregavir alone. And as we switch to tenofovir, this response is enhanced. And in fact, many patients become below the lower limit of quantitation. But what's really important here is that the RNA response is actually persistent when you switch over to tenofovir. There's not a lot of rebound that takes place in these patients, and you see continuing decline take place. That's totally different to what happens in the e-antigen-positive patients. Here you see the e-antigen-positive patients. There's a little response to enoregavir, about 1 log that occurs in the e-antigen-positive patients for the RNA levels at week 12 on enoregavir alone. And then when you switch them to tenofovir, there's an immediate rebound that takes place. And they rebound back up by about 1 log to their levels. And then over time, they actually all go back down to the new set point, which is about 1 log below the baseline set point. And this occurs despite a 3 to 4 log reduction in DNA. So we're interested in knowing, as we're increasing the dose, whether this is something that's giving you a new set point for replication, perhaps reflecting the effect of enoregavir on transcription of CCC DNA. Here's the data on surface antigen, looking at surface antigen responders. I've just put the e-antigen positive patients in here just for interest's sake. You can see that there's a reduction in surface antigen, about 0.9 logs, that takes place in what we call the responder patients. Response was predefined as a surface antigen reduction of greater than 0.5 logs at week 12, which is consistent with the interferon-based data. And you can see that many of these surface antigen responders actually continue to respond when they switch over to tenofovir. And there's also the similar response in terms of the RNA decline that occurs with the surface antigen decline, showing they move in the same direction. This is just a summary of the mass of surface antigen data we have, just showing you that overall about 30% of patients had a significant reduction surface antigen. That reduction was a mean and a median of about 0.8 logs up to as high as 1.4 logs. The effect was seen in both monotherapy and, as I showed you, persisted after the tenofovir switch and was sometimes enhanced by switching to tenofovir. We saw it in both e-antigen positive and e-antigen negative patients, and it was associated with declines in DNA and RNA, as one would expect. There are some patients that have immune flares. I'll go through those in a quick second. And this is seen more commonly in e-antigen negative patients. We looked at some predictors. This is the surface antigen level as a predictor. You can see that surface antigen is a very potent predictor at baseline of response by both DNA and RNA response. And in fact, those who have a surface antigen less than 10 to the 4 logs have a better response than those with a higher level of surface antigen at baseline. And this is true across DNA level and across e-antigen positive and e-antigen negative patients. So the surface antigen level is quite a strong predictor, as is the baseline serum IP10, which significantly predicts response in terms of DNA and RNA responses, not just the baseline, but also the reductions that you see in IP10 on enoregavir monotherapy between baseline and week 12, also predicts response in terms of reductions in RNA and DNA, very similar to what has been reported with interferon alpha therapy. The safety is very important in this study. We heard that innate immune modulators, according to Marla, sledgehammers. She doesn't look like she could wield a sledgehammer. But we like to think of them more as kind of, you know, ice picks rather than sledgehammers. We do see some patients with flares. Actually, interestingly enough, and that's why placebo control is so important and not done in many of these trials, the flare rate is actually higher in the placebo patients than it is in the enoregavir patients. This is very important when we've started to look at immune responses, because we actually see in placebo patients significant evidence of peripheral immune responses in some of these patients that flare. The flares are always associated with reductions in DNA and surface, and that is also true in placebo patients. So once you flare, there is a a concomitant reduction in viremia. No changes in any of the important parameters, and none of these were associated with any significant hepatic injury. We had one patient who had a dose reduction, that's all. And otherwise, the profile is extremely safe. We've had one person with hypertriglyceridemia that was gone 2 days later, and one hospitalization for a patient who fell down and had unrelated knee pain. No flu-like symptoms and no interferon-like side effects. So in summary, we have a dose-dependent response. We're pushing the dose forward, the 200 milligrams hopefully will be reported soon. We have some good predictors of response, such as baseline surface antigen, baseline IP10, and response in terms of serum IP10. And we're seeing declines in all of the antiviral parameters with a good safety and tolerability profile. This drug is moving forward very rapidly. We'll be doing a 400 milligram monotherapy dose study so we get a full dose range. This is because we have yet to see any toxicity from this drug, and we're continuing to see antiviral effects, so we want to push the dose to see what the maximal dose is. And then we have started combination studies, as I said, with Gilead Sciences, but also two new studies will start in the first part of next year, including a study in patients who stop nukes after long-term suppression and then are shocked with Inarigavir, and then a study in suppressed patients that we call suppressant shock. We strongly believe in the compartmentalization of immune responses and antiviral responses, and we have two studies that are taking place looking at intrahepatic virology and immunology. Thank you.